Welcome to the InnovaBuzz podcast, where we share all kinds of tips, advice, and interview guests on all things innovation and leadership in modern marketing. Each episode is a conversation with inspiring people who make wonderful contributions to our knowledge in these areas and spark curiosity and ideas to pursue. Join me, Jürgen Strauss from InnovaBuzz, and let's get into today's masterclass on this InnovaBuzz podcast.
If your company is successful, or you're doing well in market, or your stores are on trend and the product's on trend, or the services are popular, maybe the campaign is having a neutral or no impact. You're just spending money. That's something that, again, you should be critical about each aspect of what you're doing, because around the corner is a challenging time. So to have that data, to understand what that conversion is working like and how it's working today, that's where you can be more flexible and effective in market tomorrow.
Hi there, innovator. It's great to be back with another episode. I hope you've had an awesome week so far. I trust that you also enjoyed my conversations with change consultant Bob Dick and with business transformation coach Rich Everett. I'm really excited to have today on the InnovaBuzz podcast as my guest, Michael Simonetti. Michael is the founder and managing director of the technology agency AndMine, and he's been in technology and at the interface of technology and human connection and marketing for many years. In addition to AndMine, Michael is a prolific speaker and content producer on all things technology, innovation, and marketing. AndMine's philosophy is to make the complicated seem effortless, connecting people and leveraging every aspect of technology in and around these connections. A quick promotional message from our sponsor, InnovaBuzz. We help coaches and consultants build professional credibility, engage their target audience, and connect with their ideal clients. To help you get clarity about who your ideal client is and how you can connect with them to build and strengthen an engaging, enduring relationship, take a look at our Marketing Master Mini Class. You can access the Marketing Master Mini Class at innovabiz.co/marketingmaster. It's completely free and accessible without even giving away your email. In our discussion today, Michael talked to me about translating a good idea into a message that's fit for your market. He explained how it was really important to target the right audience. And he explained also how to leverage technology in a way that is simple and also connects people. Without further ado then, let's fly into the hive and get the buzz from Michael Simonetti. Hi, I'm your host, Jürgen Strauss from InnovaBuzz, and I'm really excited to welcome to the InnovaBuzz podcast today, all the way from Melbourne, Australia, which is about as close as you can get to where I am, Michael Simonetti. Michael is the founder and managing director at AndMine, a digital agency that bridges the gap between marketing and technology. Welcome to the podcast, Michael. It's a great privilege to have you as my guest.
Good morning, Jürgen. Very happy to be here.
Adam Ashton, who was our guest on episode 187 of the InnovaBuzz podcast, suggested that we talk to you, Michael. So big hello to Adam.
Yeah, hello, Adam. Thank you very much for introducing us. That was very well played.
Now, your company works on developing technology right from websites to apps to digital commerce, and you also focus on marketing and making technology work for your clients, which is something that's really core to my philosophy, because I think we kind of get seduced by technology but forget that it's actually got a job to do. I'm really looking forward to exploring with you using marketing to connect with your ideal client at a human level and to leverage the technology to do a better job of that marketing and of that human connection. So before we start talking about all things technology and marketing, tell us, how did you get to where you are today? What were some of the pivotal moments on that journey?
Yeah, look, pivotal moments. Okay, I think the number one pivotal moment was my dad. His boss gave him an Apple II when they were sort of first coming out, and you know, the boss couldn't use it. Gave it to dad. Dad couldn't use it. He brought it home and handed it to me as a 5 year old. Like, I was just starting prep. And I took to it like a duck to water. And, you know, initially there was these, I remember playing a game where it was like a snow, you know, you're running down a hill playing, you know, trying to hit through the flags or get around the flags. And that was the only game I remember playing. And then after that, there was like, Dad, can I have more games? And it was like, well, there's no more games, son. This is really all it does. So he bought me a basic book, and that got me into programming. And I just loved programming. So I did that, you know, from primary school onwards, I was programming all the time. So I was quite a computer nerd from an early stage. And so that really seasoned my programming skills, and that, you know, took me into engineering and computer science. And I did that at Melbourne University, where again, it was super simple because I'd been programming my whole life. And then that really ticks the box on that technology side. So, you know, being able to be, you know, finish engineering and finish science and do those things enabled me to get that technology side really down. But I'd always been a little bit of a different character, sort of I rebelled against most things, anything that, you know, teachers, basketball coach, everything that I did, I was a little bit rebellious. I put that to my fiery Italian heritage and growing up in that environment with my family. You know, everyone's always yelling at each other at the dinner table, fighting for food and those sort of things. So it was very competitive very early. And I think that there was a natural leaning towards marketing for me. And I wasn't a great marketer by any means. You know, I was an engineering nerd, like hands down till you know, getting through university. But then I sort of found my feet. A couple of pivotal points would have been, one, I did try and work once for Maya, and I hated it. Like, I lasted like 3 days. You know, there was too much structure, too many rules. I ended up telling off a customer one day and walking out. And that was like within my first week. I was refereeing basketball at the time and making, you know, a reasonable amount of money doing that. So I thought, wow, this is quite good. I can control my own finance here and ref whenever I want. And I was making more money doing that. So that understanding of money early really helped me. And I was refereeing basketball probably when I was, you know, 12 or 13 years old. And I did that, you know, religiously as well as playing basketball. So I was really into that sport. But a big pivotal point was in terms of, you know, my marketing now was at university. I sort of fell into nightclub promotions. And, you know, when you're doing science engineering, you're there for 5 years, or, you know, it's quite a reasonable time. And if you throw nightclubs into that mix, then it's like 7 years because, you know, you don't pass every subject. You're staying out late. You're drinking alcohol with your buddies on the weekend and partying. So, but that really got me my grassroots understanding of how people are and how people work. And, you know, it was something that I was always looking for growing up. Like, you know, why do people act like this? Why do they do what engages them? What makes them tick was something that I always thought about. From an engineering perspective, you know, like everything's real problem solving in mathematics. So it's very, very different worlds. And I found the blend of those two worlds so inspiring that, you know, almost everything I did then, you know, utilized those two parts of my skill set, or grew those two parts of my skill set. And that's basically what you see in the installation of the company today is a very strong technology side, but also this, you know, connectivity with marketing.
Yeah. Okay. Well, that's a fascinating journey, and you know, beginning very early on with computing. I guess, you know, today most people are growing up with technology, so it's something that they can't imagine being without. Whereas those of us who are a little bit older can remember when these things first came on the scene and how that actually changed things. And for me, one of the things that is interesting there is, you know, the fascination with human behavior and what drives human behavior. And I think a lot of people that are really stuck in technology kind of forget that they're still a human.
at the other side of any interaction, and you know, their whatever their beliefs and attitudes and typical behaviors are influence how that relationship is going to develop.
Yeah, absolutely. I think you know, engineers, I think there's a line that's like, you know, engineers are very good at creating solutions for problems, you know, like, but they create the problem, you know, like they found a solution and they find a problem to fit. And I the trial and error part of engineering, really, you know, there's so much technology around, but it sort of gets ahead of itself a lot. You can see that get ahead of itself a lot of times. And, you know, from back through engineering days all the way through to clients bringing us new ideas, you can really see that exists a lot. And then that human connectivity is, yeah, something that really drove me. I think it really frustrated me up till maybe, you know, sort of like year 12 or first year of university, because I just really couldn't figure it out. You know, I was too embedded in that technology world and I had no balance. You know, like I was great at the technology, but just I understood my family, understood my close circle. But as soon as I stepped out of that, I was, you know, always sort of a little lost. So I was like, well, why is it these things are interesting to people, or why are these people able to naturally connect with people? And, you know, I spent a lot of time just sort of living in that world organically. And that was that benefit of nightclubs. You know, you really, there was no technology, you know, this is all like raw people, you know, what makes them tick, you know, what really drives their fundamental emotions and what they get engaged in. And that was something that it was so eye-opening to me and such another world that I delved into that, like, throughout my university. And it was great fun, but it was also like this learning curve, and I had some great mentors around in that world as well. Even though some of the stories, you know, you're not going to talk about them outside of parties that we're drinking with your buddies, but because there's some intense situations. But I really felt that gave me that street cred and that ability to connect with people.
Mm. So when did you set out on an entrepreneurial path?
Yeah, that turning point for me probably was that little bit of work experience at Maya. You know, I sort of knew at that point that
for the listener, though, Maya, for those that aren't in Australia, Maya is one of the big department stores and retailers here.
Yeah, it's like you know, maybe a big Walmart or something like that here in Australia. Not as big as Walmart, but certainly, you know, they got stores everywhere. Especially when we were growing up, the stores were everywhere. Obviously, retail is much different these days for those companies. But I sort of knew then that it was like, okay, well, I'm rebellious. I don't follow rules well. You know, maybe I should be trying to do something for myself. And I suppose off the back of refereeing basketball and knowing how to make my own money, I was reasonably creative. I was good with technology, and we, you know, there was a time when design was sort of being moved from, you know, drawing and cutouts and screen printing to technology. You know, like it was moving towards computers. So I loved doing design, and I started doing design again for events and for nightclubs and entertainment, and that's quickly enveloped into other companies as people got to know me, and it was as a reasonable designer. I wouldn't say that I was ever a fantastic designer, but it was my stepping stone into the marketing creative world. So I quickly built a business around that, then built a printing and design business that was quite successful, and then there moved closer and closer to technology as I saw opportunities around you know, websites and digital marketing becoming mainstream.
Hmm. All right, and what is it you do today, and why do you do it?
Well, today is is like an evolution of those early days in marketing and design. Today we build, you know, we say the line that we use in the company is if it's digital, we do it, you know. So if it's online, essentially we do any part of that work. So that can be, you know, from a technology side, like building apps, you know, building mobile apps, Facebook apps, those sort of things, e-commerce websites, designed websites, you know, marketing websites, and so all of those technology pieces. And then, you know, as you step away from the pure technology or the pure builds, then it starts moving into that marketing side. So, you know, the technology side of marketing would be, say, SEO, or, you know, social media marketing, And then, you know, a step back again would be sort of pure marketing. So like, but on digital advertising platforms. So Google, you know, Facebook campaigns, you know, had digital advertising campaigns through, you know, magazines and all sorts of things that we touch. So it is that sort of connected end to end, you know, we sit in that technology camp very well. We sit in that marketing camp very well. And that's the job, is we're always trying to connect the dots between the two. You know, like the opportunity, that the real value is in between those two points, because, you know, technology is quite settled. There's lots of great platforms out there that we build on and others build on. And marketing's quite settled. You know, like there's a lot of platforms that have been around for a long time that, you know, we put digital marketing on. And, you know, we're trying to connect the two pieces to get the best out of both worlds.
Hmm. All right. Well, that's great. Now, in terms of marketing, I mean, one of the things the technology in the digital world has done around the ability to get a message out into the world, if you like, is that it's become very noisy and there's just so much out there. And I know in particular, I'm kind of going off Facebook again whilst they seem to have made a big push in the last few years to be more business oriented. Now, to me, that it's just gotten so noisy that it's just, for me, it's a bit of a waste of time. But yeah. I guess my question is, how do you, as a marketer, how do you get attention in this noisy marketplace? What are some of the things that you would recommend doing?
Yeah, I think this is everybody's challenge. And as the platforms play with their algorithms and are trying to maximize their financial return, we're seeing both the noise, which is almost everywhere anyway, and the opportunities for really great conversions at low cost being squeezed and squeezed to everybody, because, you know, the bigger money that's being thrown at, say, Facebook campaigns, you know, there's bigger players that are there that have enormous, you know, ability to take money from, let's say, what we don't do is above the line campaigns, you know, like outdoor or TV or radio, where enormous budgets were previously being spent. And as that money filters down and tips more towards digital, then yes, it becomes so much more noisy, so much more competitive, and the dollars go up. You know, like from 5 years ago, the cost of buying, you know, Facebook engagement or Facebook click-through was so, you know, 10 times cheaper, 5 to 10 times cheaper than it is today. So you've got to be ahead on every aspect. And this is where, from a technology point of view or from a you know, analysis point of view, we really put in a lot of work. So any campaign has both a lot of work that gets done there's three key areas. The first key area is, what is the message, right? It's always, what is the message? What are we saying? Why is this going to be engaging? And even with the greatest message in the world, you can still face the problem you're seeing, which is, well, I'm out of, it's just not returning the investment, even if I've got the message perfect. But let's say you've got the message perfect or you know, very close to, the opportunity is then around how we target those audiences. So, you know, the more fidelity we put in, the more detail we put into the targeting, and there's so many variables. Let's say on Facebook alone, there's probably, you know, 1,000 different variables that you can do on targeting. So, you know, it's a bit of a art to getting that message across to the right audience and then making sure that we're getting a return. But that's not always enough either. So, you know, the overall message is then, you know, how does this connect to the rest of the framework that's happening in digital? So what is the for example, what is a client's website doing? How is their traffic going there? What is their organic profile like? How are the connected pieces of their digital system working to help push that other particular campaign pathway? And if we don't see that we're firing on all cylinders, chances are that you're not going to get a great return. You know, there are still some outliers that do well for, you know, a single pathway campaign, but, you know, it is that people can get across, you know, what's thrown around in the industry is multi-touch. You know, people can get into, you know, a website, an SEO, an organic link, a social media page very, very quickly in and out and sort of get a sense of what this company is about. So if there's any interest on that company or that organization, then people do that research really, really quickly to convince themselves that this is something that they want to buy or this is a service that they want to engage with or you know, podcasts that somebody wants to listen to. So those things are all that, that fabric of online and the complexity of online is paramount to getting the whole thing right. So yeah. Although, sorry, you know, I know you're probably looking for an easier answer to that. The actual answer is, you know, like, yes, it's getting more complicated to get the whole picture, you know, condensed down to making it work.
Hmm. Well, I think you've touched on something there that is really important, and that's to be congruent with perhaps, you know, going right back to the purpose of the company, the purpose of the business, to have everything being congruent with that so that when you do have, let's say, an advertisement on Facebook that people find interesting, they click through, that everything they then do when they research further, everything they find is consistent with the expectation that they've come to, well, yeah, the expectation that's been raised in their mind by that advertisement. And I think one of the problems is, and I see this all the time when I see something and I click through and I go, well, that's not what I expected. That's totally different. Or you find that, you know, either there's not a values alignment with the company, even though the initial headline was of interest and might have been something that I would purchase, but then you kind of get put off by the rest of the information that you find. So I think having everything congruent is really important, which raises the question of, you know, how important is it to actually start with strategy and the background and lining up all those fundamentals?
Enormously these days. And I think if there's one, like a big take home for the listeners is make it simple. You know, if you're going to spend money, you're going to get engagement. If you're doing SEO, you're going to get traffic. You know, like if it's done reasonable over time, it's easy to get traffic, but what is the message after that? You know, like, have you framed them well enough that the next thing that they look at steps them down the pathway towards something that you want them to do? Or, and we see this a lot, you know, are they presented with too many options after that? You know, and that can be you know, it feels like the right thing to do to show how big the company is or how much stuff it does or how many different products or how many variations. But really, people want things very, very simple online because, as you said, the noise is both noise from competitive marketers, but also the noise that we can put in front of ourselves, in front of our own audiences, because it's too complicated, you know, and that age-old philosophy of KISS, keep it simple, stupid, is something that absolutely rings true in today's day and age of marketing because there's so much complexity. We were talking probably about what really centered this for us was mobile. You know, when mobile started to tip towards above 50% of all web traffic for all clients, you know, like it's very rare that we find someone that has less than 50% web traffic now for mobile, especially for consumers, because, you know, people are on phones and on TV, you know, when they're watching TV and flicking through things. The limitation of the screen, of a mobile screen, is small. You can't fit a lot of information on it. So that is one of the driving forces behind making things simpler. And, you know, I often talk about, I wasn't around, you know, at the Mad Men time of advertising where you really needed good hooks and really simple lines and you'd really to get it, you know, get some simple message across with a visual and a line of text. I really feel that that's how it's shifted, you know. 10 years ago, we were marketing and we had a lot of opportunity. You could grab traffic from anywhere. You could almost put it anywhere. People would spend more time. Now they've got less time, less screen size, and you know they want to make sure that that message is for them. So, you know, when you think about that audience targeting, you know, for very particular audiences, there's very particular messages. And, you know, trying to do all things at once, that's a big no-no for us. You know, like even when we see big budgets, we really try and tighten it around single value propositions and then step out from there because everybody's under pressure. Every organization is under the pump. You know, it's harder and harder to make great money. You know, I'm sure there's outliers for everything. You know, people can do exceptionally well, but people come to an agency because they need help. And yeah, it's our job to provide that expertise. And a lot of the time it is breaking it down and coming back to what you were saying around, you know, it's the word strategy. It is getting that whole strategy right. And almost like, you know, down to the team, so they know what the marketing effort is and why they're going about things in a certain way and why we're simplifying it.
Hmm. Yeah. Well, you referenced the Mad Men era and keeping a fairly simple hook that's very targeted at a specific audience and having a message that kind of entices that audience to take some action. That's how I saw that whole thing. And now, you know, at some point, the internet gave people the ability to put a whole lot of information in front of their audience, but it probably went too far because it got overly complicated and as I said, overly noisy now. But with the limitations that a little mobile screen puts on you, and also the fact that there is so much noise in the marketplace and people have to have this message with a real clear hook, it's coming back to the fundamentals, isn't it? Which is,
I think so.
Comes back to the point we were talking about earlier, that, you know, at the end of the day, if you take away the technology, it's still all about the interaction from, you know, one human to another human, and you know, how do you get the right person's attention, and how do you then tap into that attention and, you know, drive the interest and help them take the next step if they choose that's what they want to do.
And that's, I mean, look, that's exactly it. That's distilled down to the essence of it. And people aren't as critical of those next steps. You know, like, you've got to be critical of all the steps and really feel that you've got that understanding of that engagement. And I'd love it to be our, you know, like, 3-4 years ago, we're talking about split testing a lot. Oh, we can split test everything. Don't worry. You know, we can find the right message through split testing. But the reality is, the cost of split testing is impossible, right? Like, you really have to have those good ideas. You got to have that marketing ease and that style correct to really cut through at the start. And, you know, sure, you can split test 10 things and you can find which one's better, but that's going to cost you 10 times the budget. And that's just not reality. The reality is you've got to have those one or two really good ideas now and have the technology working for you as well, because that's the entry level. You know, the entry level isn't, well, we can just do the technology well. The entry level is, you need both. You've got to play both sides.
Hmm. So how do you come up with those good ideas then for that marketing idea or for that marketing message?
Yeah, well, that's the wizardry of marketing, right? You've got to. That's probably the hardest question I can ever answer. And it's also like, you know, there's an egotistical element to this. There's a confidence element to this. There's a you know, we know what we're doing element to this. You know, there's building trust with the client. All of those things, you know, come to the frame of why we're selling our services better than anybody else. And you know, we're super confident with that marketing side only because we've done it for, you know, decades now. You know, me and the team have done it for decades. So you get used to what's wrong. You know what's not going to work. That's the first thing. So when you're looking at a whole range of ideas, you can sort of feel out what's wrong, what's not going to work. And, you know, we're looking at a marketing company right now. We're branding a product into market. And, you know, it's easy to come up with ideas for names, but most of them are rubbish. You know, 99 out of 100 are rubbish. How do you pick out that one idea that's okay? And then you need a few of those ideas. So, you know, maybe out of 300 or 400 ideas for names, you're going to get 3 or 4 that are really good that you can go, okay, there's a reason behind why this is. And then, you know, there's a bit of salesmanship to articulating that, but you've got to have the confidence that you know that this is going to land in market well and have reasons why. You can't just go, well, this is a great tagline, or this is a great advertising line, or this is a great image. the explanation really comes into it, and that being able to sell that through to the client and convince them as well, because they're nervous. You know, they're like, well, we're going to put all our, it's like going to the casino and betting all your numbers on one roulette number. Mm. Like, why do you know that number's going to come up? You know, okay, well, that's where you've got to take it away from the randomness and say, okay, well, here's why. Here's some history. Here's some ideas. Here's the understanding of the marketplace. We know why this is going to connect with these people. And often, you know, even with organizations that have worked in market, that know their audience, that have got a very narrow audience, they haven't thought about these ideas for a long time because they've been comfortable doing what they do. And, you know, they wouldn't be in business if they weren't somewhat successful. You know, our job is to take that opportunity around, okay, well, it's getting challenging, or there's a new opportunity, or how do we really just take that next step and turn that on for them? So, look, in terms of how do you come up with those great ideas, I mean, it's brainstorming, it's thinking, it's thinking in the shower, it's always on. You always got to be inspired about, you know, helping this client or this organization. And I always say to my guys, like, we're here to make them more money. That's the bottom line. You know, how do you connect that piece? How do you connect people around that idea? And how do you sell better? Like, but that's the beautiful challenge of marketing, is that it is so human and so real that you get to touch and feel things and find out how good you are at it. And again, we're still in business because that's where the confidence and a little bit of ego comes into it as well. You know, that's why we're here, because we're good at it, you know. But someone said to me something very, very smart, and this is again going back to one of my mentors, Sam, in the nightclub days. He was like, look, you know, we're putting on things every week, and people have to come to the venue. And, you know, we're doing a lot of people, like, you know, 3,000 people a night would come to our venue in the city in Melbourne. It's a huge club. And he would always say, look, you're only as good as your next gig. And I thought that was a beautiful line. You know, it's not you're as good as what you've done in the past. Sure, we can all hang our hats on what happened in the past, but you've got to be good tomorrow. You've got to be good for next week. It's not being good for last week. And that's also something that I say to the team, you know, okay, yeah, you've done these successful campaigns before. But like you said, space is getting more challenging. There's more noise. What are you going to do that's different enough but commercial? That's the thing. That's a couple of those frameworks that we use to go, is this going to work? You know, yeah, we can hang our hat on things we've done in the past. Yes, we can say these things have worked in the past. This should work again. But that's not – the internet and technology is moving so fast that you found yourself, and everybody finds – gets competitive quickly, and that's, you got to cut through that.
Yeah, that's there's a couple of points that like hit me from that. I guess, you know, there's the area of having the experience of what's worked in the past and the knowledge as a base, plus an understanding of who your target market is, or who the target market for the client is. But then looking at, well, you know, what's happening right now and what's changing in the marketplace that we have to take into account here as well, because what we did yesterday won't necessarily work. And as I said earlier, you know, Facebook to me, that's just one example, but it's one that's impacting me a lot now, because I've got a couple of groups that I'd love to participate in and follow, but I'm finding it just Facebook's gotten so noisy, so I'm moving off that. So that's just one example of where there's, you know, sort of so rapid change, because about a year ago I was saying that Facebook's moving very strongly into the business sector, and now it's just gotten too noisy that doesn't make sense anymore. So there's an example of a really rapid change.
Look, as soon as you see Facebook sales support and Google sales support, you know, calling you and emailing you saying, hey, let's catch up, I can help you spend money better, right? Yeah. You know, at that point, things are changing rapidly. You also know both they're going after that middle market and the big money, and everyone's paying more because it costs to put those sales teams on. It costs to put those ideas out. But the good thing is for us, that means we get on the line and talk to them and say, okay, well, what are you guys doing? You know, what do you guys advise? And whatever they advise, that's average or below average. Mm-hmm. So we know we've got to beat that. And that's where you go, okay, yeah, I understand what you're saying, and I can do the targeting like that, and I can look at frequency like that, and I can look at these particular elements of the campaign. But what commercially gets me an advantage. And it might be a small thing. It might be just a slight adjustment to the targeting. It might be, you know, not listening to the Facebook advice and pushing through on something else. Now, again, they push their algorithms, all of them do, to squeeze more money out of you and really lock everyone down into like, this is the price, you know. When the phone books were around and they were charging for phone books, they had their price down because there was nothing else around. And I think that's really what everyone's trying to do now is like set the price in the market and dial it up. You know, like any financial piece of information, you know, whether it be interest rates or, you know, variables in the marketplace, that's what they're trying to do. They're trying to establish a baseline number and dial it up. And we always used to talk about, look, we can get it in an amazing click to your website for under a dollar. And now that just, you know, that dollar thing doesn't exist. You know, now it's an incredible campaign can get it under a dollar in terms of engagement and traffic that's going to highly convert. But now we're seeing, you know, $2, $3, $4 more. You know, in some of the SEO, SEM campaigns, you're paying a lot more. So you've got to play the field. You've got to be smarter than the next guy and you've got to be more creative. That's it. Show up and do those things and it works. But it's easier said than done. That's the thing.
Okay. So what do you see as some of the ways that you can leverage technology and be ahead of the game in terms of, you know, some of the digital disruption that's happening right now that we're seeing? And of course, there's probably stuff that's around the corner that we can't see right now.
Yeah. We look at new platforms. If there's an opportunity and an audience getting on a new platform, then there's always early wins around those platforms. You know, obviously everyone builds their platform and monetizes it, but new platforms tend to have opportunities around more cost-effective advertising. But then there's obviously a learning curve to that. There's also time and effort around putting in a new strategy for a new platform, but they exist. You know, you can get, to stay ahead of the curve on new technology, you've got to find the new platforms and new pathways. We're constantly looking at new pathways. We're constantly trialing out new platforms in terms of what's the audience on this? You know, can we get ideas up? Would a certain campaign work on this platform? You know, right now we're working on some campaigns and looking at TikTok as an audience profile and saying, okay, well, what's going to work there? You know, we're seeing a lot of content go on there, but how do we commercialize that pathway? And, you know, will we get longevity out of it as well? Like what is the runway we have on this before it becomes the Facebook or Google and it really starts to set the market starts to set the price? Aside from that, you know, it really comes down to that overall, again, it's complicated. You've got to look at the ecosystem. We work a lot on strategy on technical ecosystem. And by ecosystem, I mean, what's the website? What's the social media pages? What's the content strategy? You know, what's the organic strategy? What's the paid strategy? How do these pieces interconnect? And where are we seeing the most benefit from? And can we add something that somebody else can't do? Can we hack something together? Can we put a new group or a new pathway or a new strategy together that can sync in with that ecosystem? And again, all of this comes to back to the cost of, you know, like, what is the budget? You know, like, you don't have an infinite amount of money. You don't have an infinite amount of time. Yeah. You have to be very smart. So we talk to our clients about low-hanging fruit. What are you already doing that we can change easily that can get you some early wins? Then reinvest that piece into bigger wins. There might be very, very simple things that they haven't thought about or haven't touched for a while. But that's, you know, you need to be playing the field and playing the field intelligently. You know, you've got certain players and certain skills and, you know, we can add to that. But again, it's not unlimited. It is very limited. And that's where most people find the challenge is, what do I do next? There's a lot of bad advice as well, or there's a lot of advice out there that you can get swept up in, you know, the rabbit hole of the internet and self-learning can be great, you know, can be definitely challenging for an agency when we, you know, hear that the very basic questions and then we have to respond in like, okay, we'll explain all of this to you and become the educators around that in terms of helping control that piece and managing the client expectations. But also there's a lot of rabbit holes that, you know, you can get really, really dialed into. Okay, well, what is my particular click-through rate, or what is a great Facebook frequency, or you know, what are these little elements at the very, very bottom of campaigns, and why are they, people fixate on these things because they read them, they get it, they understand them, I'm onto that point. But how does that fit into that wider ecosystem? Again, you know, like, is it an important enough variable that we would say it's low-hanging fruit, let's go after it? Or is it something that we go, yes, this is something that you need to address, but consider it in this framework of how challenging this entire space is. You know, if there is a particular pathway a client's going down, like, you know, look, honestly, it comes to us so often. A client will come to us and say, hey, I've got this brief. Okay, show us the brief. And it'll be good, but it won't be like they haven't considered something that could be really obvious that will fundamentally improve their business. And we'll say, oh, look, have you looked at this audience targeting in Facebook? Or have you looked at this platform? Or have you looked at your tagline? Or have you looked at your landing pages? You know, like some of these really fundamental things that, you know, going back to what we were talking about before, just to condense it down and simplify it, because a brief typically creates more complexity to a campaign or an offering, and we're always saying, okay, well, how do you condense this? How do you condense the marketing? How do you condense the technology so that you're not over-resourcing things either? You know, we've talked a lot about marketing, but I think there's very, very strong similarities between what marketing does, or what marketing should do, and what technology should do. Both of them should be converging down to the simplest thing that we know is working, and then expand back out, because people are just end up throwing more and more at it. And then, you know, budgets and costs and things get out of hand, and maybe they don't have the clarity of mind to go, well, yeah, Facebook's really not working for me, like you have, and gone, okay, it's time to take a second look at this and take a breather, you know. And it's challenging for clients, especially in, say, retail that we work with that are pushing hard, that need to have something out there.
Hmm. And also the technology enables you to measure a whole lot of stuff and put together and make things a lot more complex with less work, I guess, than what you could do before technology. But then a lot of the measures, I mean, this is one thing that I always struggle with, is, you know, is the measure important? And also what insights are you getting from that particular measure or statistic that drives what you're doing and drives your relationship with the customers? And sometimes the statistic or the data is just a vanity metric, I call it.
Oh yeah, absolutely. couldn't agree.
Yeah, we've got lots of likes, or we've got lots of these things, and what does that mean? Does that mean people are buying more stuff, or what, you know, is it showing on your bottom line, or is it just making you feel good?
Yeah, look, absolutely. I think that there's definitely a shift in market that people are understanding that there's vanity metrics and, you know, things you do for yourself to make yourself feel better. Like bigger companies that we work with, they do a lot of, say, influencer marketing, and, you know, they tick the box and they've got the influencer, and, you know, it makes them feel good. You know, like they've got the name out there, they've got the celebrity tick, but does it convert? You know, that's what we always ask as well. Like, okay, it looks better. You're doing the brand awareness thing, and maybe there's a long-term play in that benefits. But we like to see the double win. You know, we like to see the win from the marketing and the influence or whatever that campaign is, and the backup in the data, the conversions, the money. You know, you got to get paid. If you can do the direct response in line with the awareness marketing, then that's a great way to work. And I always say to our clients, like, look, awareness comes along for the ride. You get more customers, they're your best ambassadors. They've got your products. You know, most products in Australia, they're pretty good. There's not a lot of rubbish that you see, you know, because there's a lot of rules and regulations around, you know, building products and services. You know, there's a high quality to everything that gets produced, and that's why we're very confident marketing our clients, because it's good products. But again, it comes back to that: are you selling? If you're not selling more, then what is your campaign about?
Yeah. I know, it comes back to being really clear about the strategy. In my mind, so that, you know, there's an argument to say, well, if you're wanting to position a brand by putting information out there and by demonstrating thought leadership And if that's the strategy, then okay, you can do that. And you be really clear about the budget on that and that the return on that is going to be a long-term thing in terms of translating to sales or so on, and that's fine. But if it's just a case of feeling good because you're getting some ticks to the boxes of we're now an influencer, but the strategy was actually to grow your sales or grow your business, then you've got to kind of look at that and say, well, I think there's a disconnect there somewhere.
And look, there's a lot of room to hide as well. You know, like successful companies can be successful for many reasons. You know, it wasn't necessarily the campaign. You know, that's why we love to wrap data critically around these things so that we, you know, we're our own best enemy sometimes, because it's tougher when you when you're super transparent around the data, around the conversion data. But that's the only numbers that we that the team work on, because that's to us that's the bottom line. You know, if you if your company's successful, or you're doing well in market, or your stores are in a on trend and the product's on trend, or the services are popular, maybe the campaign is having a neutral or no impact. You're just spending money. That's something that, again, you should be critical about each aspect of what you're doing, because around the corner is a challenging time. So to have that data to understand what that conversion is working like and how it's working today, that's where you can be more you know, flexible and effective in market tomorrow.
All right. Well, thanks, Michael. This has been really great. I could go on talking for ages, particularly on the data insights part that we're kind of just starting to touch on now, but maybe we'd save that for another time.
Sounds good.
I'm just looking at the time, and I think it's a good place to move on to the Buzz, which is our innovation round, and it's designed to help our audience who are primarily innovators and leaders in their field with some tips from your experience. So I've got five questions. Hopefully we'll get some really insightful answers that'll inspire people to go and do something awesome today.
Hopefully. Let's see.
Yeah. All right. So what do you think the number one thing is anyone needs to do to be more innovative?
Look, I thought about this quite a lot, and I think to be more innovative, it's really around trial and error. And I know that's quite a big catch-all, but, you know, doing little tests and being critical about those tests will help find the new pathways that you're gonna initially dip your toe into, but then you can put real money behind. So trial and error to us is ensuring that you've got those data pieces lined up, and that you're whatever you're testing, you're getting data to capture what that data is, what those tests are looking like. And I'm not talking about split testing campaigns. I'm talking ongoing. Really build a framework that is critical around: is this working? Is this affecting our bottom line? That is the trial and error that you should be constantly working on. And, you know, the trials are, well, what is this new platform? What can we do with this new campaign? How did that campaign work last time? Building up that evaluation, that critical assessment of your data and how it went, that's key to it. And you will change your KPIs over time. Don't be afraid of changing your KPIs. That's really important, because you might be looking at one KPI. Definitely don't look at likes, but something further down the funnel that's really important to hit. And it might adjust slightly, because you might go, well, look, this is influencing our, you know, the type of traffic coming through, or the or this particular audience. We should be more focused on that KPI. And again, there's so many variables to it, but be critical and be flexible as well there.
Yeah, well, I love that. And so don't be afraid to take experiments or run experiments, and
absolutely
be really clear about the outcomes and keep track of the measures. Yeah,
that's it.
All right. What's the best thing you've done to develop new ideas?
Look, it's for us, it's really being absorbing knowledge, you know, absorbing the things that are going on in the marketplace all of the time. You've got to be across not just what you're doing or what your industry is doing, but you should be looking at wider things and saying, well, why is this interesting? Why does this work? How is this connecting with people? We do that constantly. The team and I sit down and we constantly throw ideas at each other, both things that we're seeing in market for our clients in their categories, but also wider, because good ideas come from everywhere. And to have those ideas flowing and being around them, you've got to know what's good in marketplace or what's working really, really well. So, you know, we're constantly talking about, you know, we don't do television, but we talk about the TV ads that are resonating. Because why? Because it's connecting people, you know, they got great messages and you got 30 seconds, you know. And then how do we hook those ideas and bring them in to our products or our ideas for our clients as well?
Hmm. Yeah, there's a lot of great stuff in that. So kind of working together with other people to brainstorm ideas, if you like, and also looking at what's going on in the marketplace, even outside your own industry, and bringing that back.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you could see a small influencer do something interesting, and then all of a sudden you can convert that idea, you know, and you go, oh, I can utilize this idea. You know, you've got to shift it a little bit or change it a little bit, and that could really drop into our marketing mix really, really well. So, you know, and I know that there's an enormous amount of content out there, but it's got to be habitual to be part of that content and sort of scan through it each day.
Hmm. All right. Now, what's a resource you use most often?
So the resource we use all day, every day is our CRM. So our CRM runs our organization. We've built it from the ground up and we've evolved it over the past 10 years. Now that, you know, CRM is a big word, a big term, a big category, a big thing to sort of try and look at and how it can improve your business. The one thing that we've learned, developing our own CRM is that, you know, whatever comes out, like for people just getting into it, or even for people that are into it, whatever comes out of the box, just keep it as simple as possible. And then build the little things over time that you really, really need, because these CRMs these days out of the box can come with so much, and you can try and do so much that it'll just be a resource cost. You'll end up spending more time on it than you need. Same philosophy.
Can get really confusing.
Keep it simple. You know, keep it simple. Take away tasks that are chewing up time that you can automate, and be critical. What can I automate through the CRM that's going to save everybody time? Because we all think entering more data or capturing it into the cloud or something is going to be more efficient. But that hasn't happened. Otherwise, I wouldn't get, 200 emails a day. You know, like technology is made for us to be inefficient. So we have to make it work and make it efficient. And I think from our understanding of CRM or any software that we're using, make it efficient for you. Find ways to reduce resource, to spend less time with it, because that and spend less time entering data, because all of that just takes time.
Hmm. Yeah, that's great advice. And also, you know, systems, like I always say, that if you're looking at a particular system, how does it integrate with other systems that you're likely to use? Because that's where avoiding the duplicate data entry that you mentioned
absolutely
comes in.
Absolutely. Yeah. Simple. Mm-hmm. How do you start simple and then evolve? You know, like in no matter where you are in the life cycle of that, like when we do analysis on companies, technology ecosystem, you know, like their back end, the intranets and how they communicate within the group, it's just riddled with bottlenecks and inefficiencies. And I don't think people are critical enough of that stuff. They just think, we'll throw some new tools at it, or, you know, twist some things or rebuild and it's going to be better. But they've learned nothing from the past, because they keep thinking that technology is going to be there to solve it for them. No, you've got to pick the right tools for the job.
Yeah. Yeah. Great advice. All right, now what's the best way to keep a client on track?
Okay, so now we're talking about people again, right? So it's what we're doing today: communication. You know, you've got to follow up. You've got to be friendly. You've got to push at the right time. But all this it's really expectation management. You know, our clients rarely know as much as us. Like, you know, we're across everything all the time, and we're often too smart for our own boots. So it's constantly my team saying, look, explain it to them, make sure they understand it in layman's terms. You know, like we're there to connect on a human level. We're doing their marketing, their technology, but we have to be able to explain it. And that is the most important thing. So we can keep clients on track and ourselves on track by having those conversations and keeping people appraised of, you know, even super complicated things, just saying, you know, look, this is what we're dealing with. You know, you might not love that it's not going to be delivered till next week, but that's the reality. And we have a lot of those conversations. And again, I think the relationship and the people talking to each other is the only thing that can smooth that over. You know, if you're pissed off with somebody and you're on the phone, you know, you can feel it out on that phone, and you can say, hey, I know you're annoyed at this, or I know you're pissed at this, but look, here's the reality. You know, this is what we're working on, and we're pouring everything we can into it. it's not like I can throw five more people at this and it's going to come out better. It's really, look, this is how it is. And I think if you're honest about those things, honesty, you know, Australians are very, very good. I'm sure everybody is, but Australians are especially good at the radar. You know, if you throw them rubbish, then they just go, well, yeah, I can feel that something's wrong here. I don't know what it is. So I just say to my team, just go out there, be honest, and tell people how it is.
Hmm. All right. Yeah, lots of great advice there. So it all comes back to communication and human interactions.
Yeah, that's right. That's right.
Yeah. All right. Now, what's the number one thing anyone can do to differentiate themselves?
Ah, okay. Well, this is probably your hardest question. You know, you can tackle this so many different ways. In terms of differentiation, like almost you can use almost anything as a differentiator. I give the example of, you know, like I always wear a suit because most people in my industry, you know, they got the corduroy jeans on and the cool jacket, and you know, no one approaches it like from this like you know, business angle. And sometimes I get called a real estate agent, and I'm okay with that. But you know, it's those little things that stand out, you know, and people go, oh, you know, like I love hearing it because it gives me that little confidence boost, you know, oh, you got to meet Michael. He's the best dressed guy in digital. And I love that, you know, like yeah. I don't go out there saying that. I hear people say about me, and I, you know, it's a bit blushing, but you know, it's those little differentiators that really matter. And if you can find something that your company's doing or that you're doing that you can differentiate yourself and just have that little bit of territory, those things stand out. And yet you can dial that up into, you know, the big marketing campaigns and having and understanding different territories and who's in the market and where you need to put yourself. But it comes on a small level and it comes on a large level. So I wouldn't be overthinking differentiation. I would, you know, unless it really fits your tone of voice, it's not stunts and doing things that are crazy. It is, you know, what's something smart that I can do here that will make me different.
Hmm. Yeah, but that's a really important point there. I think you made at the end about you know, it's got to be congruent with who you are.
You can't fake it. Yeah. You can't fake it. It's got to be real. Yeah. It's got to fit you, you know. And look, going back to that suit thing just quickly, you know, people go, oh, isn't it hard to wear a suit every day? And it's like, no, it's the easiest thing in the world because I know what I'm wearing. If I had to pick my T-shirt every day, you know, or my jumper or my jeans, I'd probably leave the house an hour later because I'm too vain, you know. If I put a suit on, I walk in, I know what I'm doing. And so I get the optimization and I get the differentiation.
Mm. All right. That's great. Well, thanks, Michael. This has been fantastic. So where can people find out more about you and about AndMine and maybe even reach out and say thank you for what you've shared?
Yeah. Look, I'm one of those people that I'm always open to a chat or a coffee, and I love helping, you know, startups all the way through to large organizations. So if you've got a question for me, you can hit me up on, you know, if you search for us and mine, like yours and mine, you know, you'll get our website or our social media, Twitter, Facebook, LinkedIn. You know, we use the same handle on everything. One of those lucky things of being on the internet early, you get the handles for everything on your brand name. So that worked out for us.
Yeah. All right. That's great. And I will post links to that on the show notes as well.
Thank you.
So what parting sort of key advice would you give our listener that, you know, if they're a business owner that wants to be a leader in innovation and in their field?
Well, it's, you know, it's one of those obvious things. Don't stop learning, you know, keep pushing yourself, live and breathe it every day, and try and figure out, like the rest of us, the work-life balance so that, you know, you're not grinding and you have those moments of insight that you can come back to. You know, you've got to have something else that you can put yourself into, because if you push, chances are you're not going to have those great ideas either.
Hmm, that's right. And there's a risk of burnout. So, yeah, I love that. Keep learning, but at the same time, you know, keep the balance.
That's it.
All right. Well, finally then, Michael, who would you like me to chat with on a future InnovaBuzz podcast and why?
Well, I've got two recommendations, if that's okay. I'm happy to hook you up. A good friend of mine, Adrian Sester, owns a company, Flavor Makers, and they're doing incredible things in the Australian marketplace. You know, they produce hundreds of products for companies as well as for themselves in all of the in the retail chains in Australia. In food and beverage, and they're doing some superb work now around the Australian organics farmers and building a new brand that is going to, well, you know, once again, it's really on trend in terms of this eco farming and sustainable living. But Adrian's one of those super successful entrepreneurs, you know, like he's got the Midas touch. Everything he touches makes, you know, millions and millions to tens of millions to hundreds of millions of dollars. So he's just one unique character. And, you know, like honestly, everything he touches, he managed the band Jet, and Jet became, you know, global sensation. And you know, it's almost anything he does well. So he'd be a great one to talk to. Another is, you know, from Adam and my, you know, you mentioned Adam Ashton put us together. One of the old, we went to the same high school here in Australia. Another old boy from Melbourne High is Peter Marks, and Peter is a different vintage than us. He's one of the guys at Henslow Capital, and he's constantly working on large startup, you know, from medical to technology to automotive projects that he gets us on, which we love him for. But he's also a very charismatic and entertaining guy. And you know, he'd have a lot of interesting stories for your audience. And I'm happy to, I'm happy to introduce you to those guys as well.
Yeah, we'll do that. We'll look forward to meeting Adrian and Peter and having a chat to them as well. So thanks for that.
Pleasure.
And thanks also for sharing your time and your insights with us so generously today, Michael. I've really enjoyed this. It's been an interesting conversation around that interface of technology and marketing and human behavior. And
thank you. Been great. Thank you as well, Jürgen. I really appreciate letting me talk to your audience and sharing great questions with me, and very interactive. Thank you very much.
All right. Well, yeah, all the best for the future with AndMine as well. And let's keep in touch.
You also. Thank you. Bye.
I hope you enjoyed that insightful conversation with Michael and took something away from his episode. What stood out for me was Michael's commitment to service, to connecting the dots, and to focusing on the result in all that AndMine do. I'd love to know what you took away from Michael's episode. Leave a comment below the blog post, which you can find at innovabiz.co/Michael Simonetti. That is MichaelSimonetti. All lowercase, all one word, innovabiz.co/Michael Simonetti. You'll also find contact information for getting in touch with Michael there, as well as links to the AndMine website, to their social media pages, and to the other resources we spoke about in today's conversation. Michael suggested that we have a conversation with Adrian Sester of Flavor Makers and with Peter Marks of Henslow Capital on future InnovaBuzz podcast episodes. So Adrian and Peter, keep an eye on your inboxes for an invitation from us to the InnovaBuzz podcast, courtesy of Michael Simonetti. Remember to check out our Marketing Master mini class at innovabiz.co/marketingmaster. It's completely free and accessible without giving away your email. But most importantly, in less than 30 minutes, you'll gain absolute clarity about your ideal client and how you can communicate with them to build and strengthen an engaging, enduring relationship. And if you'd like our help to go even deeper into marketing mastery or help with podcast production, then send me an email to jürgen@innovabiz.co and we'll set up a quick call just to have a conversation and find out if we're a good fit for one another. Tune in again next week to the InnovaBuzz podcast. We've got some more fantastic guests lined up, including Jane Bedell of Dovetail Resolutions and Sarah McIntyre of Bright Inbound. Stay connected with us by subscribing to the InnovaBuzz podcast at innovabuzz.com/subscribe. innovabuzz.com/subscribe. Make sure you never miss another episode. It would also mean a lot to me if you leave us a review, because what you think matters. I'd love to hear your thoughts, your ideas, your suggestions, or questions you have, so go ahead and share them in the comments below the blog post for this episode. Until next time, I'm Jürgen Strauss from InnovaBiz. Remember, be awesome and keep innovating.